Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Bridge. It's good to have you guys with us for worship today. And before we jump into worship, just a couple of quick announcements. Tomorrow morning, very early in the morning, we have a team of missionaries that will be traveling to Haiti. And a little bit later in the service, we're going to call up the team and have an opportunity to pray for them as a congregation. But just want to let that be known even now that, you know, as you sing and as you worship, just continually praying for them will be a good thing. And then we have another opportunity for prayer tonight at 6 p.m. If you guys remember, the first Sunday of the month is our corporate prayer meeting, and that'll be from 6 to 7 p.m. tonight. And then afterwards, because the weather is cooler and because some people were talking and thought this would be a good idea, we're going to have kind of an informal time of fellowship out in the courtyard. I heard something about a possible fire pit and s'mores. And I'm assuming that's probably maybe popular. So we'll pray from 6 to 7. There'll be kind of an informal time for that after the prayer meeting. And then middle school and high school youth group also meets at 7 o'clock. But I think we're going to let middle schoolers and high schoolers at the very least grab a s'more on their way to youth group tonight. And then the other thing that is happening is 1 week from today, we are baptizing at least one person. And I say at least one person because sometimes when somebody says, yes, I'm going to be baptized, and they nail it on the calendar, then all of a sudden other people that maybe God has been speaking to about this all of a sudden go, you know what? Maybe it's time for me to be baptized as well. So good news is if you're one of those people that's thinking, I think I'm ready to make that commitment of baptism, you have an opportunity between this Sunday and next Sunday. And if you You always have an opportunity, okay? But we're already baptizing at least one person this coming Sunday. So on that note, want to encourage everybody to, we're going to read two verses from Romans 12 as a call to worship. The first one is Romans 12, 9, and then Romans 12, 21. Romans 12, 9 says, love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. And then Romans 12, 21 says, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. And we have a Savior in Jesus who was not overcome by the evil in the world, the evil in us, but overcame that evil with good. And he invites us to do the same. So I invite you to stand, greet someone you know, and we'll begin singing Always in a little bit.
Trouble surrounds me, chaos abounds. Amen. Let's lift it up to him this morning. We got to show him appreciation for always, right? That's a pretty strong word. And I'm sitting here as I think through the chorus. I will not fear. His promise is true. My God will come through always. Does that sound like a reckless God? Interesting. We're going to sing Reckless Love. And, you know, when this song came out right at first, there was a lot of people going, reckless? We can't call God reckless. And I just wanted to read to you real quick the words from Corey Asbury, who was the writer of this song. This is from his heart when asked that question, because he was confronted about this a lot. And here's what he had to say. When I use the phrase, the reckless love of God, I'm not saying that God himself is reckless. I am, however, saying that the way he loves is in many regards quite so. What I mean is this. He is utterly unconcerned with the consequences of his actions with regards to his own safety, comfort, and well-being. His love isn't crafty or slick. It's not cunning or shrewd. In fact, all things considered, it's quite childlike. And might I even suggest, sometimes downright ridiculous. His love bankrupted heaven for you. His love doesn't consider himself first. His love isn't selfish or self-serving. He doesn't wonder what he'll gain or lose by putting himself out there. That's reckless. Amen? Let's sing.
Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind to me.
Oh, we overwhelmed me, never in
deserve it, still you give yourself away.
You may be seated. You know, as we sang that song together, I was reminded of the fact that all too often I don't believe that God's love looks like that song described. That He does come and do whatever it takes to get us back to Him. And just want to invite you today, if you wrestle with that, or maybe you just know that, or maybe that song just touched you deeply, just to rejoice in that fact, if it touched you deeply, and if you're like, I don't believe it, just say, God, help me to be able to believe that you love me that much. This is that time in the service where we are going to call up the Haiti team. It's a big team, so it'll take a little while for them to come up here, but we do want to invite them up on stage with us so that we can pray for them. And as they make their way up, I was blessed to spend about a half an hour with them on Thursday night and was impressed with the way God has united them and bonded them together already in preparation for this trip. Some of them have gone to Haiti multiple times. Some of them, this is their first time to go to Haiti, but they are excited and anticipating with great expectation what God is going to do in them and what God is going to do through them. God is the great missionary, and they all know that. And He's invited them into the story. And Natalie, do you have anything you want to say? No? Okay. All right. One thing before we pray is just kind of the reminder of like, okay, well, why do we pray in general? And why do we pray specifically for a mission team that's going out on a short-term mission trip? And I'll tell you what God does in me when I pray, and I think it's grounded in the Bible, that as we sang the song always, there was a verse that was quoted. It was Psalm 121:1 that says, I lift my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Prayer is a lifting your eyes. And sometimes when you lift your eyes, you may be going, I don't know where my help is coming from. And God, by His Spirit, grabs our hand, our face, and just locks us in and says, your help comes from me. So prayer reminds us of God's presence. It gives us God's peace. It provides us with power to live the life and walk the walk that God is calling us to live and to walk. So very early in the morning tomorrow, like 5-something in the morning or something like that, this team is taking off. I said they're walking in the feet of Jesus because there's this verse, Mark 1:35, that says, very early in the morning, while it was still dark outside, Jesus went to a solitary place and prayed. It will be dark outside when they leave and head to the airport, but they will have light in themselves, and we have the opportunity to pray for this team. So Usually when we pray for a team like this, we just encourage people just to extend an arm in their direction, just kind of as a solidarity to them. And please join us in praying. Father, thank you so much that you are at work in our midst and that you have called these men and women and children to journey and watch you work in Haiti. Lord, we pray that you would provide them with your peace, your presence, your power. Thank you that you promise us you'll never leave nor forsake us, and that there's not a single place that we go that you will not be with us. Lord, we pray that even now we know you are setting up divine appointments for them with people, brothers and sisters of ours that are in Haiti, and those that may not yet know you. Lord, may you glorify yourself in them and through this team. And Lord, help us to be faithful to lift them up over this next week. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right. Cool. And Natalie reminded me, a lot of times when we pray, you guys can head down, we pray about something and we don't ever know how it went afterwards, but we've already set up a day, October 20th, which is 2 weeks from today at 5:30 p.m. The Haiti team will be back in this building sharing about the experiences they had and how they saw God work. October 20th, 5:30 p.m. It'll be out in an email and we'll circulate an invite as well in the week to come. So.
So you can stand again, but at this time, we're going to let the kids from birth all the way to fifth grade, so basically all the noisy ones, to head back to their classrooms for children's church. We're going to dismiss them. As you can see, we have quite a few. And as they're making their way out, let's just let's say a prayer for them, okay? Dear Lord, thank you so very, very much for the sound of children. We know you love them. We know you protect them. We know they are in your care. And so it's our responsibility to make sure they hear about you. Now, Lord, watch over us as we continue our song service and as we work into the message. In Jesus' name, amen. This next song is probably one of my favorites. And it's probably one of my favorites because it just talks about the power of God. You are God alone. You're unshakable. You're unstoppable. There is no one like you. This is the God who keeps me in his arms.
You are not a God created by human hands. You are not a God dependent on any mortal man. You are not a God in need of anything. That's just the way.
God, we come to you today with thankful hearts because of those words that we just sang. Lord, you're unchangeable, you're unshakable, you're unstoppable, and you are God alone. Lord, we've been reminded about that over the past couple of weeks. We talk about those distractions and idols in our lives and food we eat and can't eat and so on and so forth. And Lord, we just have to continue to remind ourselves, it's very simple, that you are God alone. Lord, plant that in our hearts and our minds today. And every minute of every day as we go from here, you are God alone. Not created by human hands, not dependent on any of us, but God alone. Lord, I just ask that you bless Stephen as he brings your word. Open our hearts, our minds. We know that each one of us here has something to hear today that helps change our lives. And Lord, we want to be sensitive to that today. Send your spirit. Have him sit here with us. Have him plant these things in our heart that you're going to bring to make obvious to us today. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. May be seated. And if you have your Bibles with you today, we're going to be journeying on in 1 Corinthians. We're going to wrap up chapter 10 and do the first verse of chapter 11. But we'll start in 1 Corinthians 10, 23. And before I read, I want to skip down to 1 Corinthians 10, 31. That I think is one of the key features of this passage of Scripture. And it says, so whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all for the glory of God. So there's this big, all-encompassing word that's called whatever. Whatever you do, you're supposed to do it to the glory of God. But then there's this word glory that we really don't know a whole lot about. We know the Bible talks about glory a lot, but we also don't use it in our normal day-to-day language unless we're well-versed in what's called Christianese. So what does the word glory actually mean? What is glory? And I've heard a lot of definitions of glory, but I think the best one is to shine brightly on someone or something to display and show his character or her character. So last night, my family and I bragged about my son last week because he beat me in the 5K. We'll do a 2 to 3 minute version of now this week, me bragging about my dad because he got an award last night at his alum university, McKendree College. It was a humanities award. But he was one of about 12 people that got different awards. Some people got inducted into the College Hall of Fame for sports and a number of different awards. And everybody had an opportunity to give a speech. And it was really, really interesting how each one of these speeches deflected the glory from themselves either to God or to others in their support circle. So it's interesting that a lot of people will look at God, and people that don't fully understand God will say, oh, well, God just wants to be worshiped, and he just wants to be glorified, and he's just kind of interested only in himself. But actually, the brighter he shines in your life and in my life, the more we are built up, the more we are encouraged, the more we see him as he was supposed to always be. So what happened? The Garden of Eden, we'll go back there for a second. Remember, Adam and Eve ate the fruit they weren't supposed to eat from, and they went and they hid in the bushes, and God comes after them. They're running away from God. They're hiding from his presence, and therefore they're also hiding from his glory. And ever since that moment in the garden, God has been pursuing you and I with a reckless love to say, hey, I'm here, and I'm good, and I'm kind, and I love you, and I'm unstoppable, and I'm unshakable, and I want you to experience my glory. So when Solomon dedicates the temple in 2 Chronicles, it says that the glory of God filled the temple. And people were amazed, and they bowed down, and they worshiped. I have moments, I'm sure you have moments, where you experience the glory of God. I remember one time when I pastored Otterville Baptist Church, we had this group of people that were praying before, like, you enter the sanctuary, and they had these old, so I think they still do, saloon doors, you know, the saloon doors that, like, from the Sunday school wing to the sanctuary. Anyway, it was fun. The saloon doors were entertaining for a lot of reasons. But anyway, I pushed them through, and the presence of love and grace and glory of God just, it filled the room. It was one of the closest situations I've had to what Isaiah may have been experiencing when he was in the temple and he saw the Lord high and lifted up, and the train of the robe of his robe filled the temple. And now Paul's saying, I want you to glorify God everywhere you go and in everything that you do. The good news is, when that's your heart posture, guess what? God will reveal his glory in special ways. But people of God did not always hunger for that glory. They did not always want to look to God. And guess what? I don't always hunger for that glory. And there's a good chance that you don't always hunger for that glory. And sometimes it might not even be on your radar. It wasn't on the Corinthians' radar. So Paul has to tell them, hey guys, you're talking once again about food sacrificed to idols and if you should eat it or if you should not eat it. And I'm here to tell you that actually, even though we're going to talk a little bit about food sacrificed to idols, it doesn't really have a lot to do with food sacrificed to idols. It has a lot to do with glorifying God and loving God, the other in your midst. 1 Corinthians 10, beginning with verse 23, this is God's word to us today, says this: all things are lawful, but not all things are helpful. All things are lawful, but not all things build up. Let no one seek his own good, but the good of his neighbor. Eat whatever is sold in the meat market, without raising any question on the ground of conscience. For the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. If one of the unbelievers invites you to dinner and you are disposed to go, eat whatever is set before you, without raising any questions on the ground of conscience. But if someone says to you, this has been offered in sacrifice, then do not eat it for the sake of the one who informed you and for the sake of conscience. I do not mean your conscience, but his. For why should my liberty be determined by someone else's conscience? If I partake with thankfulness, why am I denounced because of that for which I give thanks? So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. Give no offense to Jews or to Greeks or to the church of God, just as I try to please everyone in everything I do, not seeking my own advantage, but that of many, that they may be saved. Be imitators of me as I am of Christ. Let's pray. Father, you know what your word means. You revealed it, and we ask that you reveal it to us today. I pray that you would hide me behind your cross, that I would not get in the way, but that I would be an instrument of your voice, so that each person that leaves this place may leave saying, I heard from God today. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So how do we know if we're glorifying God in day-to-day experiences? We had a community group, met, talked about this. By the way, if you're not in a community group, I invite you to join a community group. There's opportunity to dig into scriptures like this on a weekly basis and bounce ideas around. But in our community group, one thing that came up is I said, so can you, just came up with all kinds of stuff. Can you open a door to the glory of God? Can you close a door to the glory of God? Can you drive a car to the glory of God? Can you brush your teeth to the glory of God? What do you think? Is all of life supposed to be captured by an overwhelming awareness of God with us and God in our midst? I think you have two groups of people in Corinth, and one group of people says, you know what? I can do whatever I want, and God is not really even on my radar when I think about it. And then you have another group of people, God is not really too much on their radar either, but a list of rules are. This would be called the legalist. And the legalist has made a decision. They have come up with a list of things that if I do these things, then God loves me and I can save myself and be acceptable to God. But there's at least two problems with a list of rules. First of all, have you ever made a New Year's resolution? Or two, or three, or four? You know what the famous thing to say is now with New Year's resolutions? I just resolved not to make a New Year's resolution. And that becomes your New Year's resolution. Well, why don't you want to make one? Because deep down inside, you know that by at least the time March hits, your resolution is pretty well gone. You are setting yourself up, even in your own system, to fail when you are trusting a list of rules. Now, some of you may go, Stephen, I'm offended by that. You don't understand my self-discipline. I can do it, okay? Let's say you can. Let's say you're much more disciplined than I am, and you have accomplished it. But then what you're tempted to do is to take your particular list of rules and judge that as the target of holiness. So when everyone is obeying your list of rules, you look around at the people that are not obeying your list of rules and go, they must not be a good Christian or a good person, or they must not love God because they don't obey the rules the way that I do. And a lot of times, the list of rules is more than just the Ten Commandments. It is the additions of which there's shades of gray. Food sacrificed to idols is a gray issue where sometimes Paul says, eat whatever's put in front of you, and other times he says, don't eat what's put in front of you. The other thing that's easier about rules is when you have a rule, you know whether you follow it or whether you don't. But when you're faced with a situation and you don't exactly know what to do, you have to trust the Holy Spirit to guide you and direct you based on certain principles. But then the enemy can do something interesting, and he can kind of like handcuff you, because you can go, oh, well, for example, I had the situation happen yesterday. I was on my way to the pool and a neighbor grabbed me and said, hey, I really need to talk to you. Do I talk to my neighbor or do I go swim? Swimming's good. Talking to my neighbor could be good. What do I do? Well, what does Paul say? And by the way, I went and swam. I set up a meeting to talk with my neighbor tomorrow. Okay. You can do sometimes a both and, but the one that is captured and imprisoned, and Paul's talking about liberty in the Christian life, may go, oh, I will always give. Or I will never give. And it is a give and take and a both and. And we got to figure out how do we make these decisions. So verse 23, all things are lawful, but not all things are helpful. First thing Paul says when you're faced with a decision, is it helpful? Is brushing your teeth helpful? If you want to keep your teeth, it's probably helpful. If you don't want to repulse people with bad breath, it's probably helpful to brush your teeth. Should you brush your teeth? Probably. Some of you are going to go home and go, what did you learn at church today? I learned I'm supposed to brush my teeth. Hopefully you learn more than that, okay? But yes, you should learn that. All things are lawful, but not all things build up. So basically, Paul says, you have opportunity to do whatever you want, but I want you to aim high and not low. And here's the low bar. The low bar is, well, morally, it's pretty neutral. It's not like I'm committing adultery or I'm murdering someone or I'm stealing something or I'm lying, so I guess I can do this. That's a low bar. And Paul says, I want your bar to be higher. I want you to ask yourself, not just, can I do this because it's morally neutral? I want you to ask yourself, is me doing this building up myself or building up someone around me? And it's a bigger story. The word for build up or edify in Greek is often used to build a house. There's a couple of people in our congregation that are pretty heavily involved and very wise in building things. I can't build a Lego kit, but I've tried. And you know what's interesting in building things? You're building it up for what? A protection, for provision, for safety, for a place of refuge. So let's build up this metaphor and say, what is God saying then we're called to do in building up ourselves and in each other? We're called to build each other up spiritually. We do this through the word. We do this through preaching and teaching. We do it through prayer. And Paul says in 1 Corinthians 8:1, knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. We do it by the way that we love each other. So on my way to church today, I'm in a hurry. I'm running a little bit late and someone decides to cross the street and they're going slow. Never understood this. I always think to myself that if I'm crossing the street and I see people going, that you can at least do a brisk pace. These people are like this. I guess it was the Sunday stroll. It is Sunday, but it was out of this world crazy. I couldn't believe how slow they went. But then I had to ask myself, is my attitude toward these people really building them up right now? Maybe this person can't walk very well. It's as fast as this person's going, and I'm upset when they're doing the absolute best that they can. You see how quick we are to judge without having all the facts, without having all of the knowledge, without having a full understanding of what's going on in any given person's life at any given time. Who did I want to build up? Me. Get off the road so I can get to church and worship Jesus and preach a sermon. When maybe love is the most powerful sermon that you and I can ever preach. That empathy, that a listening ear does more to free in some ways the spirit in our midst, to reveal the glory of God any more than any judgmental glance or critical word ever could. Jesus said that the world will know that you are my disciples by the love that you have for one another. So building up involves love. The building up also involves obedience. Ephesians 4 tells us that we are called, some people have been given spiritual gifts, as Ephesians 4, 11 and 12. But the purpose of our spiritual gifts, whether we're evangelists or preachers or teachers or whatever it may be, is to equip the saints for the work of the ministry. Equip the saints for the work of the ministry. That there is a work that needs to be done. I've shared this story before. It's still on my bucket list, but it hasn't happened yet. The funny thing was, I decided I was going to try to do a triathlon in 2007. I think I can do a triathlon, but I still haven't done one. But in 2007, I got a book on triathlons. And you know what I did? I read the book. But I didn't compete in a triathlon. The Word of God is the book. And it's not to downplay the book. But even this book says, and it's on the back wall here, that we are called to be doers of the Word and not hearers only. Another example, you go to the gym and you sit on a bench and you watch everybody lift weights. And after a week, you check yourself out in the mirror and you've not noticed much progress. You're like, man, I don't understand this. I'm in the right room. What's the story? So you continue going and sitting on the bench and watching others lift weights. And after a month, you still are not any stronger. There's no muscle definition. You can't figure it out. Satan has duped us as a church into believing that we can sit in the right room and read the right book and be built up in our faith without actually applying the word to our lives. When you are called to build up yourself and build up others, we don't work for our salvation. We are saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, for the glory of God alone. But Paul does call us in Philippians 2 to work out our salvation. You are called to Christian workouts. And this is part of it, coming and hearing and worshiping and learning. But when you go out the door, God is going to give you all kinds of opportunities where maybe someone slowly in front of you crosses the road when you're in a hurry, or the unreasonable person that you don't really like to work with at your workplace, or a spouse or a child or a parent that you're called to forgive. And that is the rolling up of the sleeves and saying, God, I want to glorify you as I work out my faith. I don't just want to hear it and walk away. I want to hear it and apply it. And it is in the application that transformation takes place. I'll give you a quick example. Remember Zacchaeus? He was a wee little man. He climbed up on a tree. Jesus said, hey, get down from that tree. I'm going to go and eat with you today. Zacchaeus was a tax collector. He had stolen and ripped people off for years. Jesus has a meal with him. And at the end of the meal, Zacchaeus says, Jesus, I realize what I've done. I've ripped people off. I've been wrong. And I am going to pay back everybody I cheated 4 times the amount. And then after Zacchaeus says that statement, does Jesus say, today salvation has come to your home. That the Spirit of God filled Zacchaeus with the fruit of repentance and godliness and obedience. And that fruit, and part of that fruit, displayed itself with, I was wrong, and I know that though first I should start with I'm sorry also has additional action connected with it. And Zacchaeus's action of repentance was, I'm going to pay it back. And Paul is saying, when you build up yourself and others, obedience is a key part of this process. Not only building up yourself, but in verse 24, it says, let no one seek his own good, but the good of his neighbor. We already talked about this, but there is the question of, if you're wondering, will this be good for me or will this be good for my neighbor? Paul is saying, I want you to lean toward seeking to serve your neighbor. Maybe I shouldn't have swam yesterday. Maybe I should have met with my neighbor on the spot. Good news is, we're meeting tomorrow. There is some freedom, but there should always be the constant question of, how is what I am doing going to build up other people? Just use this as an illustration in like marriage or parenting, guys. Most of the time when I've got a bad attitude in marriage, or I get to hear sometimes about people that struggle in marriage, and one of the biggest complaints, and I do it myself and other people do it, is, you know, she just doesn't care about me. You guys catch that? She doesn't care about me. When maybe it should be flipped. How am I caring about her? That there is a building up that takes place when you're saying, I will put others before myself. Now, I've discovered something about myself. I'm not able to do that. There is far too much selfishness in Stephen Helfrich to pull that off. So if there's far too much selfishness in me to be able to do that, how do I get the power I need to put others before me? Ezekiel 36, and this is worth flipping to. I promise we're not going to preach that whole chapter also, but this is an incredible illustration of how I think Paul intends for you to love your neighbor as you love yourself. And first of all, it starts with the glory of God. And in the glory of God, what happened in Israel is Israel basically said, you know what? I like all these other gods more than the one true God. So I'm going to worship them. So God decided, okay, I will let my people have their way and they can worship other gods, but then it led them to captivity. That actions have consequences. And in Ezekiel 36, verse 20, God comes to defend his glory and his name. We are Christ's ambassadors, but God himself defends his name. But when they came to the nations, wherever they came, they profaned my holy name. And that people said of them, these are the people of the Lord, and yet they had to go out of his land. So the other nations are looking and going, this God of Yahweh, this God of Israel must not be that strong. But I had concern for my holy name, which the house of Israel had profaned among the nations to which they came. So God is basically saying, I'm going to make right what people have done wrong. Every time I choose selfish sin over God and over someone else, God turns around and says, okay, Stephen, I care about my name and my reputation. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to remove, which we're getting to in Ezekiel 36, your heart of stone and selfishness and sin. And I'm going to put a new heart in there. And I'm going to give you the desire and the power that you need to love other people. Ultimately, what Paul says you need to love people well is a spiritual heart transplant. You can't do it apart from that. So let's look at Ezekiel 36, 24. God says, I will take you from the nations and gather you from all the countries and bring you into your own land. I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean from all your uncleanness and from all your idols. God's giving us a bath. I will cleanse you, and I will give you a new heart and a new spirit I will put within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules. God has this amazing promise to you and I that says, I'm going to cleanse you, I'm going to make you right, and I'm going to put my spirit in you that will actually cause you to build up others and to love others the way that you're supposed to. Back to 1 Corinthians 10. And now the case studies of food sacrificed to idols. And I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this, because ultimately, the heart of the matter is, when you walk out that door, if you and I can say, God, I don't build myself up the way I should, and in my holy faith, and I don't build others up the way that I should. And guess what? I can't do it unless you intervene. Would you put in me your spirit that will cause me to do what I can't do apart from you? You're going to be good. You know, when this like rubber really meets the road, when you go to a different country or a different culture or a different context. So all those people up here that we prayed for about Haiti, guess what? This will not be hard for them to apply this week. They're going to be in a country and in a context and in a culture that is a bit foreign. They're not going to as easily be able to depend on their own intellect and experiences. They're going to have to be saying, God, guide me, lead me, empower me, help me. I'm going to be careful, because you guys are going to have a hard time in Haiti in some ways, and God is going to be faithful and provide and come through. So don't hear that I'm saying, oh, you guys are in for a week of a cakewalk. I know better, you know better. But here's what's interesting. For the rest of us that are going back to our normal day to day, it will actually be easier for you to not be so desperate. And that is a bad thing. That we need to be desperate for God and his spirit to fill us, to help us make decisions. And when you're on a mission trip, you're more in tune to that reality. When you go to work on Monday morning, you may be less in tune to that reality. So Paul says we are called to give thanks with the decisions that we make, and we're called to glorify God and build others up. And then at the end, Paul says in verse 33, just as I try to please everyone in everything I do. Now, there are healthy things about being a people pleaser and unhealthy things about being a people pleaser. And Paul just says he's a people pleaser. But other places, he's highlighted the fact that he's ultimately most responsible for pleasing and glorifying God. But as he's glorifying God, he's saying things like, I'm not going to unintentionally or intentionally offend someone that doesn't need to be offended. Sometimes saying nothing at all when you disagree with someone is okay. Sometimes giving someone the benefit of the doubt is good and godly. And then Paul's final verse here that we'll cover, be imitators of me as I am of Christ. A verse has never really been one I've fully understood, because ultimately Paul now in this place is saying, guess what, guys? Follow me, because I'm following Christ correctly. And it just smells a little bit like arrogance. What is Paul up to here? Really? He uses him as the case study? But then I began to think about that weight room. When I was a freshman in college, I did not lift a lot of weights, but it was required as part of the whole swim team workout rhythm. And I had a weightlifting partner that was a year older than me that had been through everything that I had been through. And I don't even know where he was with God. But you know what he said? He said a few times, hey, watch me, watch my technique, watch the way I'm bending my elbows or not bending my elbows. Don't do it wrong. See how I'm doing it. And it was a guide. It was a director. It was a mentor. It was a coach. I've heard it said before that in order to have a healthy Christian life, every Christian ought to seek out three people. You need a Paul, you need a Barnabas, and you need a Timothy. Now, you're going to have a hard time finding somebody named Barnabas. Paul's and Timothy's are a little easier to find. So obviously, you're not looking for those actual names. What they're saying is you need a Paul, that someone is a little bit more advanced spiritually. They're growing and you see their growth and you know that they can pour into you and mentor. You need to seek out a mentor. And then they equate the Barnabas as you need a good friend that's kind of on the same level as you are to encourage you along the way. Barnabas means son of encouragement. And then you should look for a Timothy, someone that's younger, could be younger chronologically, but doesn't have to be. They're younger in the faith. And that it's your opportunity to kind of be a Paul figure to that person. You're mentoring them. You're building them up. You're encouraging them. But ultimately, in relational discipleship, that we are called to build each other up and that we need to do this strategically and intentionally. Heard someone say one time, who are the people that you're praying for? And the person responded and said, oh, I'm praying for everybody in the country. Okay, give me the names of some people that you're praying for. Everybody in the country. But they didn't have specific names. Or God bless the world. Not a bad prayer, but a little general, a little impersonal. What if in building each other up, we say, God, guide me to a Paul, a Barnabas, and a Timothy. Three people. And I'm saying is it should be givens that you pray for your family and your church family. Okay, so that this is in addition to that, some Paul's and Barnabas's and Timothy's could come from your family, biological family, and your church family, or your neighborhood. But what if everyone leaves this place and says, God, I want to get serious about working out my faith, and I want to apply it, and I want to be obedient. And would you show me and guide me to a Paul-type person, a Barnabas-type person, and a Timothy-type person? And help me. Speak through me. Use me. Put your spirit in me so I can be one who builds others up. And whatever I do, whether I'm eating or drinking, I'm doing it for your glory. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word, your spirit today. Thank you that in any given moment, you're doing abundantly more than all we could ever ask or imagine. God, thank you for bringing us to the place where we hear your word. But as we prepare to sing and then leave this place, help us to be the kind of people who don't only hear your word, but do your word and apply it and work out our faith for the benefit and the good of others. Remind us today, Jesus, that you have promised to put your spirit in us and that you're constantly interceding for us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God uses all of us as a body of believers to build each other up. But I'd be remiss if I failed to say that Jesus is ultimately the one that builds up his church. That Jesus is the head and we are the body. And that Jesus will guide and direct you to what you need to do and who you need to talk to each step of the way. But I also want to encourage you that this is a promise that God says when we call on him, he will hear us and he will help us and he will guide us and he will empower us. So our final song is going to be Standing on the Promises. So it'd probably be appropriate if we stood. And as you stand on that promise, there might be somebody even now that you're like, I think I need to reach out to this person. Maybe this person might consider encouraging me and building me up in the faith. Or I think I need to be more intentional about pouring into this person. And if that happens, normally I don't encourage like phones out and text messages, but I think that quick obedience is good and healthy. And if the Spirit prompts you, shoot a text. And if the Spirit doesn't prompt you at this moment, just keep your eyes open. And know there's somebody that God wants you to build a relationship with in order to build up in their faith.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest, I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises I now can see, perfect present cleansing in the blood. Makes free, standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises I cannot fall, listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all in all, standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. One more time, standing.
Show your appreciation this morning. Lift up to him. Amen.
So the other promise that God made that shows up in our text is quoted from Psalm 24. It says, "The earth is the Lord's and everything in it." You're going to walk out these doors and you're going to experience God's glory through creation. The Bible says that the heavens declare the glory of God. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it. And that God wants to put his spirit in you and I in such a way to cause us to know the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. And that I have his spirit in me and I am his ambassador and representative. And I don't just want to make decisions on what's morally neutral. I want to make decisions based on how does this build me up and how does this build others up in the faith. Let's receive this benediction. And now, God, to you, the one who builds us up through your Son, Jesus, may you put your spirit in us so that we may leave this place and declare the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. And as we go about our day-to-day, may we look for those opportunities to see you at work, to join you, and to be amazed at what you do in our midst. Thank you for the promises that you're with us and in us and will work through us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. May you go with God's grace and peace.